Good evening, everyone. Today's topic is balanced scorecard. You know, a topic which is quite close to my heart. I am exposed to this particular management concept for quite a while now. And in a way, I am also not just a fan, but also an advocate of this particular management concept, because I have seen it in action and I have seen how powerful it is. We will get into a little bit of detail about it, not in great detail, but a broad outline about this concept, so that, you know, we get a working knowledge of this particular construct. But before I start, you know, I just wanted to lay a few things, which is, maybe we can call it the foundation, we can call it the genesis of the balanced scorecard framework. Now, the first thing is, of course, we all know the balanced scorecard is something which has been popularized by, in fact, the concept is very simple, you know, it is very intuitive, like many other, almost all management concepts. But it has been institutionalized, it has been codified, it has been made popular by Robert Kaplan and David Norton, you know, with their pioneering article in Harvard Business Review in 1992, followed up by another one in 1993. Then, they have also written multiple books on the subject, and they are sort of, we can call them the fathers of balanced scorecard framework. So balanced scorecard essentially addresses a very key issue of the business. The issue is that when we look at business performance, you know, we look at because we are shareholder, we look at because it is indication of how the economy is doing. We look at it as, if we have, a customer, if you are a supplier, if you are part of the same society, same country, you know, globally, all the time we are looking at business results or the results of organizations. But one of the gap, I will say, at the risk of generalization, is that when you look at business results, you typically look at the financial results. And it has two parameters, two very important parameters and one sub-parameter. One is, what is the revenue and what is the profit? And there is another term which is called profitability. There's a difference between profit and profitability. Profit is, revenue is the money one earns by selling a product or a service. Alternately, it is called the top line. If we deduct all the cost, which is direct cost and indirect cost, direct cost is, if you are producing something, the cost of the raw materials, the cost of the labor who has been involved in producing, if you are into services, obviously there are some people involved, which can directly be attributed to the product or service, is called direct cost. And anything which is indirect, like, senior management cost, travel cost at the corporate level, or business development cost, marketing cost, branding cost, is indirect. So if you subtract the direct and indirect cost from the revenue, you get the profit. And profitability is the percentage of profit. So the profit divided by the revenue, whatever is the percentage, is called the profitability. So these are the, basically three parameters people look for. How is the business doing? What is the revenue? What is the profit? What is the profitability? But one key thing about this is that these are, these you come to know after things have happened, right? So you get a quarterly result, you get a yearly result of a particular organization. You feel good about it, you feel bad about it, you say it has performed, underperformed, overperformed, but thing is that, what can you do about it? The time has gone by, right? And this is very similar to the, GDP data, where, people say that our growth has come down or growth is going up and all that, you feel good, bad, ugly, whatever, but you can't do much about it. Because these data is something which is the outcome of a lot of things which has happened in the background. Now, what are the lot of things is actually the crux of this balanced scorecard framework. You know, the indicators which you typically look at, and that is not just as restricted to business, but in many other spheres of life is, you know, the indicators which are all, which has already happened. And that way they are called the lagging indicators. You know, they have, you know, they actually, the indicator, the activity is behind the indicators, right? So it is lagging. So, you know, you look at sports results, you know, maybe in India, every time there is a Olympics, we feel very frustrated. We say, you know, we have not got any medals, but that is what is the outcome. But there are, you know, hundreds and thousands of things which goes behind it in terms of selection of the athletes, you know, creating the right infrastructure, the training, the nutrition, the science, and years of practice, right? And which ultimately shows results in the Olympics. And that is where, you know, some of the countries do very well and some doesn't do well. You know, country like India, we don't do very well, though it is improving over a period of time. So the things which you do to make an outcome, you know, they are actually called the leading indicators. I told it the other way. What is the outcome which you see is called the leading indicators, and the indicators which actually goes into making the outcomes are called lagging indicators. So if you take the analogy of the sports, for example, you know, if you want to win, say, World Cup, which, you know, we are not even qualifying in the top 32 countries for many years, probably we have qualified only once. If you want to do, and we say that, you know, next World Cup, we should be in the first 32 countries in the world, I think it is next to impossible. Right, so you probably have to plan for, you know, a 16 to 20 years time frame, and then, you know, start building the you know, the right infrastructure. Then you have to find out people who are very young, maybe, you know, below 10 years, who has the right potential, bring them into camp, you know, give them the right food, give them the right training, give them the right nutrition, you know, train them, you know, refine their skills, make them more and more competitive, make them play with more senior players. And as they grow, you know, make them play with their contemporaries in the world who are at the same level, better level. Then we take them to the next level of senior players. And maybe, you know, after 20 years, we'll be a, you know, very strong team to reckon with. We'll be a competitor to get a World Cup in football, right? So the Kaplan-Norton balanced scorecard fundamentally, you know, rests on this premise. The Kaplan-Norton principle, you know, essentially looked at business and said that, you know, we always look at these leading indicators, but we, you know, most of the businesses, you know, they at best what you can do is fire the CEO and the team and get a new CEO, but things may not fundamentally change because the background work which is going on in bringing the business results, you are not really probably focusing, right? They wanted to bring, but in a framework where we can do the fundamentals right, the substructure right, as you may say, so that the superstructure, the outcomes becomes robust. And they, you know, gave it a structure. They talked about, you know, this balanced scorecard framework, which you look at it, but there are a few other things which they talked about, which is the, you know, the goal setting, the metrics, the goal flow down, the strategy map. And these are the terms, you know, which is in the same family. And we'll see a little bit of them as we discuss. Okay, so I will go into the sharing of the screen. I will actually share a brief PPT, but it may not be a lot of things. So this is a balanced scorecard, an introduction. I will move to the next one, which is the sort of history. So as you see that, you know, the balanced scorecard was something which was, as I said, was in 1990s. Kaplan and Norton developed the balanced scorecard. You know, the first very important paper, the balanced scorecard measures the drive performance. It came out in Harvard Business Review in 1992. 93 was balanced scorecard, putting balanced scorecard to work, and Office of Strategy Management. Essentially, once you have the strategy, using the strategy map and balanced scorecard, you know what you really do to implement strategy. Because everybody talks of great things in their strategy, right? But very few companies actually succeed. There are a couple of things which I wanted to, you know, recap or share again. The first thing about this is that this is a very simple framework. You know, it's not something a great discovery. A lot of its value is understanding the fundamentals and having the discipline to do the things as the structure talks about. You know, and a lot of success depends on doing the right things rather than, you know, understanding the concept. Second is, you know, if you look at management school, you will always find that there are, you know, the hundreds of concepts. Every year, there are tons of books are written and people come up with, you know, this strategic management and, you know, bottom of the pyramid and, you know, the value multiplier. You know, the management is full of these concepts, the terms, the jargon, as you say. But if you look at how many of them have survived over a period of time, they are only a handful. You know, you and even among them which are famous, some of them may not be, you know, used on a day-to-day basis, right? So business process re-engineering, for example, James Champy talked about it, but you don't hear much about it. You know, you hear this five forces model or Porter, but you know, you don't use it much because you feel that it is very static, right? We, of course, bottom of the pyramid was a great thought which Siketola brought in, but you know, I don't know how much you know that is relevant today with the information age, everybody getting converged. But balanced scorecard as a concept is almost 30 years, it's going strong. And I think the strength of it remains in fundamentally looking at the basics and explaining it in a very, very, you know, simple term. So I would suggest that all these three papers, which is there out here, the links are given, you can just use it and yeah, you can read them. So it's good to read, spend some time available, and it will be a good perspective. The next thing, you know, I just wanted to talk. Now, one of the very important thing of balanced scorecard is, you know, the perspectives. You know, so the perspective as a word, we also know that, you know, what's your perspective? You typically talk to each other and say, you know, can you tell me what's your perspective of this particular situation? And business context also, we talk about, you know, this new leadership has come. What's your perspective? What's your perspective of blue chip companies? What's your perspective of economy, performance, and stuff like that? Now, so in the balanced scorecard, you know, context, there are four perspectives which Kaplan Norton has laid out. So the first perspective, and which we have already discussed, is the financial perspective. You know, how well the organization is doing financially. So what is the profit? What is the profitability? And what is the revenue? Now, there is no point doing a business which doesn't make profit, because ultimately businesses are there to, you know, maximize the wealth of the shareholders. You know, the money has been put in business to make money. You know, business is not a charity. Of course, you can always do charity by putting the same money somewhere else, but when it has been put in business, it has to make money. Why it has to make money? Because only when you make money, you can attract right people, you can make the right infrastructure, you can build efficiency, you can, you know, improve technology capability, you can have better processes and systems, you can do better branding, and you can do more business. So you have to make money. Without money, making a loss-making organization doesn't make any business sense, right? The profitability and the revenue are the three very important things. Now, business to business, organization to organization, it may change. You know, for some organizations, like, for example, if you look at, you know, in IT industry, where I spend a lot of time, you know, you will also have things like, you know, what is the revenue productivity? What is the per person? You know, the revenue that is coming per year, because, you know, the people are getting billed, right? you may have other perspectives, right? You know, that how much of my people are inside the country, outside the country, you know, the offshore onshore, again, a very popular concept in information technology area. You know, in the some other business, you may have things like, you know, what is my, you know, what is, say, par, somebody like Boeing may look at, you know, whether my par aircraft revenue is going up, you know, or par aircraft, the absolute profit is going up, right? Somebody may look at, you know, if somebody is doing a very niche or a very high, you know, highly branded, differentiated product, they will typically look at, you know, that if I sell a jacket, or if I sell a phone, or if I sell a, which is high end, you know, what is the profit per product I am doing? Because, you know, it is not just that, you know, I Ferrari can never think of making 100,000 million cars, right? It has to make only limited number of cars so that, you know, there is always a desire to own a Ferrari. So they have to really look at, it's not just the price of the Ferrari, but what is the per, car, the sort of profit I'm making. But, you know, if somebody is working on, you know, making, somebody is making a pin or safety pin or something which is millions in numbers, they might look at, there are so many businesses which are very low margin. For example, most of the manufacturing business are very low margin. Right, you know, cement business is operating at 2%, 3%. So they have to really look at what is the revenue, because you cannot make it a 20% margin business, but you can expand the capacity and make 100 million tons of cement by consolidation and sell it. And instead of 1 billion, if you are in 10 billion, it's a 2%, your profit is still higher. Profitability is same 2%, but profit is higher. And then you'll obviously have certain advantages of, you know, consolidations, economics of scale and stuff like that, and, you know, profitability will, profit, absolute profit will actually also go up, and profitability also will go up, right? So that is the financial dimension. But then, you know, where from is your business coming from, right? You know, you, so what is required to get the revenue? What is the first thing you need? The first thing which you need in getting a revenue is to get some customers, right? Who are your clients? Right, so every business has to have a set of clients, right? And then we talk of good client, bad client, happy client, you know, customer advocacy, customer satisfaction. So if you are in banking business, you have various types of clients. You have, the retail customers. If you are broad-based large bank, you can have investment bankers. So if your corporates can be, corporate banking will be your customers. Investment banking, where you buy or sell large properties, you know, large, organizations or companies, they are your customers, where, you know, the senior executives will be your customer. The same way, if you are doing your corporate banking, which you're giving loan to a company, in the same company, the finance team will be your customer. Retail banking, you will have somebody buying a car, the car loan, you know, that buyer of the car, buyer of the house is your customer. Or if you're giving short-term loans to small businesses, they are your customer, right? So everybody, whether you are in services or products, you have to have customer, because without customer, you don't have a market to sell. And without a market to sell, you actually don't make revenue, right? So the second perspective of business is the customers, right? So first is the financial thing, and then is the customer. Now, if your customers are satisfied, right? If the customers are happy, vis-a-vis your customers are unsatisfied or your customers are unhappy, this makes a world of difference, right? So in the same business, you will find that some people are making more money, some people are making less money, some are closing down, some are growing. And it's fundamentally, it is because the customers are, you know, either happy with you or not happy with you. So the question is that if the customers are happy, what are some of the advantages that comes to you? First thing is that if the customers are happy, they will like to buy from you. So your revenue obviously, you know, goes up, right? So if I'm happy with, say, my, Dell is the laptop I'm using and I'm happy, the next time I want to buy another laptop, I'll buy them. most probably I'll try to buy Dell, everything else being equal, right? But if I'm unhappy, I will try to buy another brand because, you know, so your revenue is going up, then I will be ready to pay a premium. Suppose the product I'm buying is 5% higher, but I will say, you know what, I have seen this product, it's better, but, you know, battery life, you know, it is much more easy to use, nice software, the customer service is very good. I don't mind giving 5% extra. So you'll get a premium. And if you get the premium, your profitability will be higher. Third thing is that, you know, since the person will be buying more of your product every time and also advocate to others, you know, if some friend says that, you know, I want to buy a laptop, what do you want? What is your suggestion? And, you know, I will typically probably say, you know, go for Dell. You know, I'm very happy as a customer, right, for a long time, right? So your sales cost is coming down. Your business is coming without much of effort, right? Your branding goes up in the market. A lot of people are saying good things about you, and that will actually improve your image. That will also bring down your cost of capital, because banks will be more willing to give you money. They will feel, you know, I don't mind giving money to these people because they have a good image, they are doing a good business, their customers are happy, my money is more secure with them than others, so I'll give them money at a lower interest cost, right? So happy customers can make your business good in many ways. And unhappy customers will not just make you lose your profit and profitability, they will also go and foul mouth you and, you know, sort of prevent other people from being your customers, right? So that is the second perspective. If you really look at only the business financials, you know, it will not happen unless your customers are happy. But then the next point is that, you know, how do you make your customers happy? How do you make, you know, with everything else being equal, you know, today, if I can take land, you can take land, I can have money, you can have money, I can recruit people, you can recruit people. And we are broadly in the same, you know, many ways we are same. We are going probably to the same bank. Maybe I am going to SBI, you are going to ICICI, not much difference in interest rate, maybe same. Land is in the same area, will be same cost. I can attract talent, which will be at the same pool. Then how the hell, you know, you are going to make a big difference vis-a-vis what I'm, what, you know, I have, right? So the difference comes in, you know, what is that you are doing inside your organizations? What are the processes and systems you are following? You know, what are the processes you follow to, you know, get a customer, right? What are the processes you follow to, you know, retain a customer, to keep in touch with the customer? What are the processes you follow to sell to a customer? What are the processes you follow to take the feedback, you know, customer satisfaction assessment? How do you make rectification? How do you take back the communication to the customer? How do you produce something, whether it is product or service? How do you refine it over a period of time? How do you ensure consistency in quality? How do you take feedback and do replacement policy, right? So the next perspective is that, you know, what is your processes and systems? Processes and systems. And unless you have great process and system, you know, we can always say that, you know, customer is a king, customer is a queen, but if you don't have a policy or process which actually makes customer feel special, it will never happen. You know, nobody will believe, right? And to do all this, to have this world-class process and, you know, have these great customers and of course have high amount of profitability and all of that, you need to have what? You need to have high quality people and infrastructure. Now, infrastructure, let me first tell, infrastructure is two parts. One is the physical infrastructure, like the office, the quality of office, the how comfortable it is, and all of that, and the digital infrastructure. Now, there is significant dependence on the people performance, everything else being equal, which is obviously very understandable when it comes to technology. You know, for example, I'm talking to you on this Zoom, and today a lot of companies who has great technical infrastructure to continue to work in spite of COVID, because it just enables people, right? Of course, having the, you know, the hardware and software is not enough. You have to give training, you have to enable people and all of that. And second is the physical infrastructure. You know, people have to come to your office, they have to feel comfortable, they have to have a good place where the level of camaraderie is there, along with privacy, meeting rooms, you know, some, you know, time for lunch, whatever food to be given, if people are coming in their own vehicle, the parking, if people have to travel, you know, struggle for 30 minutes to get a parking lot. By the time they enter your building, you know, the office, they may be totally frustrated, right? So digital physical infrastructure, but the more important thing is the quality of people. And here I'm not saying that, you know, going to the best of best institutes and bringing in the best talent, because talent is only what based on how they perform. So it's not just bringing the best, and I'm not necessarily saying you have to go to the best institutes. You have to have a process to select the people who are best and the most capable and commensurate to the requirements you have. And then how do you train? How do you keep them motivated? How do you keep them engaged? How do you ensure that you have a good culture? How do you ensure there is transparency? How do you ensure people tell the truth, right? And how do you ensure there is a group culture, not individual focus? How do you ensure that the training development is good, the compensation benefits are good, and, you know, at least at par with the market, where people can actually see there is a future, and that's where they dedicate themselves, right? So that is the fourth perspective. So, you know what? So this is the four things which I talked about. So the financial perspective, the customer perspective, the process system perspective, and people and digital and physical infrastructure perspective. Now, if you look at it, financial outcomes will come only when you have great customers, and great customers will happen only when you have great process and systems, and great process system happens only when you have great, you know, people, digital and physical infrastructure, right? So that is what, you know, so you have to essentially build a balance. And if you look at the first one, the financial is the lagging indicator, but the other three, that if you invest on people today, process system today, and client relationship and building the, you know, customer base today, tomorrow your financials will definitely show up in a positive light. So these are actually the lagging indicators which are there today, but ultimately will essentially give you the leading indicator benefit, right? So this is the balance which you have to really bring in the four things which you talked about on the right side, the financial perspective. How are you looking at the shareholders, you know? So profitability, profit, revenue. How the customers see us. Do they trust us? Do they want to do repeat buying? Do they advocate us? So internal perspective, you know, how are your process system? What are you doing good, better than our competition? People perspective. You know, are they creating value on day-to-day basis? And on the left side, it's essentially the same thing has been built on, you know, the financial perspective, internal business perspective, or the process perspective, customer perspective, and innovation learning perspective. You know, only when if you have good people, you will have innovative ideas coming in, people constantly learning and delivering on results. Now, all these things are good to hear. And, you know, if you ask anybody, who runs a business, you will say, you know, I have focus on profit and profitability and customer, and we want to have great process, we want to have great systems, we want to have great place to work, and we want to have great people. So everybody wants to do, you know, there's this buzzwords, right? You know, the customer is the king, the share, you know, profitability is the maximization of the profit is the goal, you know, people are our assets, you know, process is what we want to excel at. But then how differences happen between companies? Because most of the time we talk about it, but we don't really boil it down into how do we measure? What are the, you know, how do we measure that we are doing good? And of course, financials are very easy, you know, relatively easy to measure, because you always know, you know, revenue is easy to know, profit is easy to know, profit, also revenue, profitability is easy to know. But when you come to other things, like, you know, are you doing good in a customer? With customers and customer like us, right? Are we doing good in our processes? Are we doing good with our people? It becomes increasingly difficult. So that's where, you know, companies have to go and find out how to measure. And you'll typically have, for customer perspective, you'll have this popular thing called the customer satisfaction survey. So you go to the customer, find out, you know, vis-a-vis the competition, how are you doing? How is our product, service, responsiveness, you know, that ability to learn? Are you solving the problem? You know, you can go and look at, you know, what is the brand recall of your products and services for the company, right? aided brand recall, unaided brand recall. Aided brand recall means, you know, you say that, you know, my company is ABC, have you heard about it? And if so, what do you feel about it? Or unaided is you go and say, you know, in this market, in the market you are in, what are the three companies, the name come to you without telling that you are coming from a particular company and see whether your name is behind that, right? Then you can look at, you know, the surveys which are done by independent agencies, you know, are you identified survey, not the survey where, you know, after the result come, you say, oh, I have made it in top 10. But these are the top surveys I want to be in top 10, right? So same way, the people perspective, you look at, you know, employee satisfaction, you look at what sort of attrition you are having, how many people are leaving within, joining of 6 months, joining of 1 year, how people are growing in your organization, whether your, you know, the leadership is coming from inside or outside, you know, how many external forums your leader, you know, people are getting accepted. In the internal processes, you can look at, you know, how quickly your, you know, whether your productivity is improving, whether you are taking less time to create, less people to create a service or a product, whether your product quality is going up, you know, whether you are bringing more intellectual property, more, you know, the patents, if you are in R&D, how many, you know, how fast, stuff like that. So you have to essentially bring in not just the perspective, but the right metrics. You know, set up the right goals and, you know, find out what is the outcome, right? So a couple of things here. One is the metrics is very, very important. So whatever you want to measure is important to you. First, make sure everybody understands that these are the metrics you should be using. Second is that, you know, you have to also make sure that everybody understands that what the metric means. What is revenue? Everybody should have the same understanding. Then we have to set the goals. If you don't set the goals early on and later on end of the year, we look at the results, whatever will be the result, we'll say that is the best result we have got, right? So we have to find out goals, and goals has to be reasonable. It can be very low, it can be very high. It probably will be little more than what you can achieve so that there is a stretch. Then there should be very clear clarity as to who is owning the goals and when they have to, you know, achieve the goals. We also have to see that, you know, the goals are not individually owned and there is no other owner. So ultimately all goals has to be owned by the board of directors, and they will slowly come down to the managing director and then other senior executives all the way to frontline. And it has to be a goal alignment and there has to be a goal flow down, right? Otherwise, you know, goals in isolation, if the frontline security guy or frontline HR guy or frontline, you know, technology guy has a goal which is not mapping all the way to the CEO or the board, that will not be performed because only that person will be responsible, nobody else, right? So that's again a very vast area. We probably need another day to do that. I just wanted to bring this, you know, the same thing which you talked about. There is this financial perspective, you know, achieve profitable growth, attain world-class cost competitiveness, improve market share. These are some of the things based on the industry you are in. They will change, you know, customer perspective, retain profitable customer, you know, obviously get rid of non-profitable customers, but don't get rid in a manner where they become very unhappy with you and go and, you know, talk about it in the market, right? Acquire customers through new offerings, business process, internal process, external process. Internal processes, products, services development process. External processes, of course, the process like, you know, how the sales team will behave, how marketing will happen, what sort of events, what sort of metrics you're looking at, you know, how many calls a sales team will make, how many, what is the revenue productivity part for new sales, existing customer sales, all that, right? To improve all of that. And then you have the learning and growth. You know, the one is the people, second is infra. Infra has two parts, digital and physical infrastructure. So if you look at it, if you have good people, you will have good process. If you have good process, you have good customers. And if you have good customers, you do well financially. So all the lagging indicators will give you a good leading indicator results. If you look at from the other side, which is the arrow on the right side, you know, if you make good money, you can invest in customers, you can invest in processes, you can invest in good people. So in a way, it is connected both to bottom to top or top to bottom, and in a way, you know, they are all interlinked. It's not that you start with finance and make good, take good people. You have to start with good people, good process, good customers, and financials will automatically happen. And that is where the perfect balance has to be brought in. That is the responsibility of the senior management. The next is the reading. These are the 5 books of Kaplan and Norton has written. detailed books. Maybe they run into 2,000 plus pages. But you know, before you jump into it, you know, this is probably a good thing for the practitioners. But if you recollect, I have mentioned three HBR articles. Maybe it will be good to start from there to get a perspective and look at some case studies, pick up some videos on the way on YouTube for you to get a good sense. Now, of course, if you want to be a practitioner, if you want to adopt in your organization, you have to have some level of expertise. And that is where you can start. You know, we talked about, balance. The scorecard, which is balanced in all respect, is the balanced scorecard. And then the way you define your strategy, essentially, you know, the previous one, it is this is a map, right? You have to do, and this is what you have, you know, maybe 10 things or 15 things you have to do to achieve your strategy. This representation is called the strategy map. There's a second book. Third one is strategy focused organization. How do we bring in alignment, focus as the strategy, as the primary focus for achievement of the organization, entire organization. Next is, of course, everybody understands what is the strategy, how it is to be achieved, and how the talent and everything else is to be aligned. That is the alignment and execution. You know, how do you get benefits after good execution? There is of course another one, which is the strategy. The Office of Strategy Management is another concept, which about which the paper I have mentioned, you can pick it up there. So I stop here. I think that is what the broad thing. Anyway, you can reach me on this contact details. That's it. Nothing more. Take some questions.